that I would come at a time like this. And so it's something when you know that you are in the divine presence of the Lord, and you are in the divine timing of God. And so I want you to get your Bibles, if you would. If you don't mind, Pastor, move the pulpit over. I'm stepping of the pole here. Still clipping in and out. I could show you. Thank you. Thank you.
I'd like to
you to go with me to the book of Exodus. The book of Exodus. And if you can park your Bibles at the 25th chapter of Exodus and put your finger in there, and then move with me to Hebrews 9, 23 through 24. In coming to the tent this year, from being away for about 2.5 months probably out of the country, and I wasn't on vacation, and I thought when I was on my way to get healed, but the Lord had a different plan. And the Lord took me away for such a time as this, because there were some things that he wanted to reveal to me. And so I've been preaching now since I was 12.
My God.
And so tonight I have nothing to prove.
All right.
But I have to be sure that I am set properly to say. And I'm
doing this perfect will.
In the book of Hebrews, the 9th chapter, the 23rd to the 24th verse, and it reads as follows: Therefore, it was necessary that the copies of the things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with a better sacrifice than these. For Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. So as we look at this passage of scripture, when Pastor asked me to preach the tent, I started asking myself about the purpose for which Pastor Bory, many years ago, put up the gospel tent. And so I recognize that if you don't know the meaning of the thing,
well,
then abuse is the inevitable.
Yeah.
You don't know why you're doing something, then you'll abuse it.
Yes.
Not even knowing that you are abusing it.
Yes.
And so in looking at the tabernacle and understanding the fact that tabernacle was a typology of Christ, and that everything in the tabernacle, every part of the tabernacle, represented Christ. You find Jesus Christ in the curtains. You find Jesus Christ in the grave. You find the works of Jesus Christ even in the colors of the curtain.
Yes.
You find Jesus Christ at the brazen altar. You find Jesus Christ at the brazen ladder. And when you look in, you find him at the table of showbread. You find him at the lampstand. You find Jesus Christ at the altar of incense, which is our intercession.
Yes.
But then you move behind the veil, and even in the veil, you find Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Yes. When you get behind the veil, there is a small box where you find Jesus Christ. And so, in looking at this box, then we recognize that the entire purpose of this tent, this tabernacle meaning tent meaning tabernacle, was to house this small box. That was its purpose. Its purpose was not, and please let me paraphrase this. The purpose was not for a choir. The purpose was not for a praise team. I'm not hearing y'all. The purpose was not for instruments, because there were no instruments in the tabernacle. I'm not hearing nobody say nothing. That wasn't the purpose. The purpose wasn't the fact that if we didn't have an organ, then we couldn't praise God. Because the presence of God was not manufactured, and it did not need amenities in order for the person that's going into the presence to praise God. Because the power of the box was there, anybody that went into that area, you couldn't help but to be overcome by the presence of the Lord. And when I look around the churches today, we're working too hard, and we're doing too many things, because it's a glory now that we got to manufacture. Who am I talking to tonight? But when we recognize the power of the box that was in the tabernacle, we know that it was a glory all by itself. It didn't need to be manufactured. It didn't need nobody to help it. Are you hearing what God is saying? And so if there is no box in our tabernacle, then what are we doing in the house of God? Then what do we call the tent this year? Other than some fabric and some poles and some sawdust and some people. We are repeating ourselves every year if we don't put a demand on the box. Somebody said we got to put a demand on the box. Well, you said that you almost made it. I said, tell somebody you got to put a demand on the box. I said, it's time to put a demand on the box. So then why do you say we have to put a demand on the box? I got to walk through this. Pastor asked me to preach, and he asked me to preach Sunday and Monday. And he said, if you feel like a Tuesday, so you know what, I don't have to be in a hurry. And I don't have to kill the cow in one night. So I got to take my time and talk about what the problem is. Why is it that Christianity is falling apart? Why is it that people are leaving the house of God? What is the problem? Is there a reason why church has become like a revolving door? People join and then you don't see them anymore. Oh God, I hear the Holy Ghost talking up in here. And somebody said, well, you know what? Well, listen. Maybe it's because the glory of the Lord is not in the temple. Well, if that's the reason why, then we have to ask ourselves, why? What's the name of said, what happened to the glory? Y'all didn't stay back for a minute. I got about 5 people in here that understand what God is about to say. I said, touch your neighbor, what happened to the glory? Say it again, what happened to the glory? Say it one more time, what happened to the glory? I turn around and ask your neighbor, say, neighbor, as a matter of fact, do you know what the glory is? The glory ain't jumping and shouting. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. The glory is not the piano or the organ. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. That's not the glory. The glory. Somebody in the in order to find out what the glory is, you got to go back and see what the original intent of God was when he displayed his glory. There was a reason why the glory came. And there was a source from which the glory protruded from.
Jesus.
So he said, what is the glory? What is the glory? Look this up, Pastor. It said one of the words, the Greek word for the word glory. The Greek word for the word glory is apogeism. Apogeism. Well, what does that mean? I know that sounds like it's some strange to do with the same manifestation as to explain something that looks like an explosion or a brilliant flash. Apocalypse. An explosion and a brilliant flash. So we see that there was an explosion when God got through laying out the tabernacle. The thing that I realized in laying out this tabernacle, and this is why he was going to help us tonight, that the Bible said, and when Moses had completed the construction of the tabernacle according to what God gave him, then the Bible said there was an explosion that the glory of the Lord fell and filled the house. Because every detail of what God said had to be in place was in place. It was a process. You can't just walk in the tent and get the glory. Listen, I'm talking to somebody. Because what I'm finding out is that this generation don't want revelation, we want relief. And so what God is saying tonight, I'm ready to produce the real glory. I'm talking about the kind of glory where can't nobody stand up and preach. I'm talking about the kind of glory where can't nobody stand up and say, why am I talking to the light? I'm talking about the kind of glory that cannot be explained. So then who was this glory? And why did this glory come? Who was this glory and why this glory come? Who was this glory and why did this glory come? So when the priest walked in, and they had to take the blood of a lamb. And they had to walk that blood. I know some of y'all said, well, I already know that, but just humor me, baby. But they had to walk that blood through that veil. And they had to place that blood where God said he was going to meet them. He didn't say, I was just going to meet you in the praise. But he said, I'm going to meet you on the mercy seat. I'm going to meet you right there. He said, what I want you to do, watch this, what I want you to do, so that nobody won't get it twisted as to whether or not I will accept what you are offering me as a real sacrifice, I'm going to put the cherubim on each side of the mercy seat. Watch this. They're going to be a four-faced beast, and their job is to kill anything that comes. And it's not, oh, you don't hear what I'm saying. He said, their job is to kill everything that's fake. Their job is to kill the fake preacher. Their job is to kill the fake evangelist. I'm not hearing y'all. Their job is to kill the fake praise and worship leader. Who am I talking to? Because I believe that we're in a time now that God is about to release the activity of the cherubim. I'm not hearing y'all. And I hear the Lord say, I got to take my glory to a place where man cannot contaminate it. He said, so what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to pull it back until the church gets thirsty for the real glory. I'm not here to talk to me. I'm going to make them have to have church for 2 and 3 hours before they feel. Because we in the last hour, it's going to be the real glory. Can't get nobody to say amen about this. It's going to be the real glory. It's going to be the glory where the Father will shut up. Well, you don't care if you don't get no praise. It's going to be the glory that when you sing, you don't care if nobody sees you. It's going to be the real glory that when you preach, you are offended when somebody says, I enjoyed your message. Because if you saw me, then you didn't see God. Jesus, have mercy. Who am I preaching to?
way of glory. Don't nobody want to be out here in no heat. Don't nobody want to be carrying on no tradition. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Don't nobody want to be doing this because my mama did it, because my daddy did it, because my uncle did it. I got to have a purpose. And I got to know why God gave it to them.
Yes.
And I'm not going to do it with the same moment that God gave it to them.
That's right.
It ain't no sense in me doing it. Because for Pastor Boyd, it wasn't about offering. For Pastor Boyd, it wasn't about the choir. For Pastor Boyd, it wasn't about the singing of the organ. It was about the soul. I'm not giving out a talk to me. There I go, shot. You came to the pit, but did you bring anybody with you that need to be?
Thank you.
They put the cherubim on both sides of the mercy seat.
Yes, yes.
Their job was to judge that which was not holy.
Yes.
Wait. So what man Shekinah take? What was it that made Shekinah take it? She said, you're going to walk the blood on here. And you're going to put the blood on the mercy seat.
Yes.
Watch this. He said, because what that's going to tell me is that y'all ain't in the outer court just had a church.
Come on. Jesus.
But that somebody done brought a sacrifice
yes.
to the altar.
Yes. Jesus.
And something died.
Yes.
Cut that whole shit out of my side.
Come on, Jesus.
He said, when I see the blood, it activates heaven.
Yes.
He said, I came down to dwell with them. He said, because my son, he said he was slain before the foundation of the world was laid. And somebody said, well, how can that happen when in the spirit there is no flesh? Because everything in the mind of God exists as is. So what are you talking about? What is the Shekinah of God? What came down? Okay, well then let's look at God. Let's see how awesome he is. Take all of the night sky and put it in your body. Take all of the daylight and put it in your body. Take the sun and the moon and stick it in your body. Take all of the oceans and the waters in the earth and stick that in your body. Take all of the land that you see, all of the mountains and the hills and all of the animals. Everything that's got breath and stick that in God. And then you've got something that is holy. And I'm not talking about holy because I feel a rainbow or I see a light. Holy means whole. Y'all ain't saying that. And it's the blood that makes us whole. Are you hearing me? Listen, the priest couldn't walk in there without the blood because anything that's not whole can't stand in the presence of God. Why y'all looking at me like you don't know what I'm talking about? Why are you looking at me like, what is she talking about?
My God.
I know why you're looking at me like that. Because we're so used to being half done.
So you.
We're so used to being sick and still praising God. We done become accustomed to our condition. But I came in this church tonight to tell you that it's time to be made whole. And God is not going to settle for the pieces of you. God wants you whole. And the Shekinah glory of God wants to touch down in this place. So what does that mean, sacrifice? What does that mean, the blood? What does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean? Show yourself. What does that mean, the blood? You gotta ask yourself. What is God talking about?
Because
there's a difference between having church and experience. I'm going to say something.
Glory.
If then nobody get saved,
come on,
in your service,
come on, now.
You did not experience
you did
not. A touchdown from God. Well, I'm not getting nobody to talk back to me when it's okay. Because we can keep pretending that we want to. Y'all ain't saying nothing. That's why churches are drying up because ain't nobody about souls no more. Ain't nobody doing no street witnessing no more. Ain't nobody going to heaven. How many of y'all came early and you're all out in the park and say, we have an attempt about it. Do you want to be saved? Or we can sit and get if you want to with each other. And we can have some good old church. But we're not experiencing the Shekinah glory of God. Who am I talking to? He didn't promise us a presence. He said, I'm going to send my Shekinah.
Wait.
Is the Shekinah glory of God?
Yes.
Of what? So listen to Jesus in John 17:5. Now, Father, glorify me together with
yourself
with the glory which I had with you before the world was laid.
Teach this.
John 17:24 says, now, Father, I desire
that they also, whom you have given me, be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory, what you have given me before the foundation of the world. And so I can read to you about 30 scriptures that would declare that when the Shekinah glory showed up, standing above the cherubim, it was Jesus Christ himself. I can prove to you in scripture that when Moses went up into the mountain and the glory of God spoke out of the light, it was Jesus Christ. Because the Bible said no man has seen God and yet no man has ever seen God. So every manifestation of God that you see, it is a responsibility of Jesus to reveal what God looks like. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Where is the church today? Are you kidding me? So if the Shekinah glory is Jesus Christ, then Jesus has no need to show up unless somebody needs to be saved. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. God, where is the church tonight?
He showed up in a tent like this.
Yes, yes.
Because the whole world. And he said, I need some blood.
Yes, yes.
Because I need a replica of what has happened before the foundation of the world was laid.
My God.
I need to see my blood.
Yes.
Because my blood is my identity. See, you can be a type A and get sick, and they put O in you and kill you. It's got to be your blood type. In order for them to say, that's John Bowie. In order for Jesus to say, that's me. Then it has to be the blood of a lamb. Come on, somebody, you're not hearing me. Every typology in the Bible was a representation of the reality that was coming. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me, but I'm going to tell you that Jesus is coming.
And I got on while the glory shows up. And I got on the necessity of Jesus dying for us. And the Father offered him up. When I got on the fact that if we don't present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, we are waiting in a familiar spirit. But you're not in the high glory of God. And it's that spirit of deception that makes you feel something so that you can think that you are right. Because when God kicked you up in the rain, you won't feel nothing. But you come back with an assurance. You see Jesus. Come back, let us get all the shout in here. He starts talking about the Father and his sacrifice and how he presented his son. And I looked up. And he said, get your camera. When I stepped out on the balcony, here comes the sky gate. And I start backing up. He said, I'm going to reveal to you today that I'm talking to you. He said, here it is. The Father offering up his baby.
Jesus.
I said, God, wait a minute. I said, are you serious? He said, I'm telling you that this is what has to be done. I blew it up. It's the Father offering up his son. And I start crying, and the presence of God came all over me. And then he turned. He said, and I'm offering up as a sacrifice. He said, and this is what the altar of incense look like. It don't look like sa-ta-ta-ta-ta. It don't look like praise and worship. It looks like smoke from something that just died. And so if you worship in God, and nothing in you is dead, it is not the real worship of God. Why is everybody here looking at me like that? But if you don't let God see your pride, then that we don't worship. If you don't let God see your bitterness, then that we don't worship. If you don't let God see your lust, then that we don't worship. And just something if you die. I'm going to take you up in strength and in power. And I'm going to take you swiftly. He said, get your camera. And there was the eyes of an eagle.
Jesus.
He said, I'm sending you help. I'm sending you help. I'm sending you help from a divine place. I'm sending you help. Not just one. Not just a pretend picture. God is going to let me reveal it to the world after a while. But he said, I sent it to you. And I said, okay, God. And I said, Lord, I don't want to do this. I said, because how do I know you're talking to me? The scout came to me another day, about 2 weeks later, and he came on top of me. And he said, get your camera. I got my camera and went outside. He said, keep your ears to my lips. And the lips showed up in the atmosphere. And I said, God, what are you saying to me? He said, I said, keep your lips to my ears, because I'm talking to you in this season. I'm prophesying to you in this season. I'm speaking to you what is to come. God, I will call. When I got through, I said to the Lord my last day before I came home, I said, God, are you pleased? He said, yes, sir. The sky started coming again. He said, get your camera. He said, I said, I'm pleased. And he showed up himself. I'm here to tell you tonight, I don't have time for it. And if anybody in this church really wants something from God, and you say it to yourself, I've been in the same place long enough. I've been just praising God long enough. But Dr. Biden, I need a revelation. I need God to do something different in me. I need God to, oh my God, to shift my belly until I know that I'm having a real relationship with God and not a relationship with the church. In this building a second. In this building a second. In this building a second. alone is it going to be a help me, Lord, prayer. Before it becomes a use me, Lord, prayer. Because I told you, you're worthy to be used. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. Who am I talking to up in here? How long are we going to stay content with where we are? How long are we going to make excuses for who we are? To the point that now we're starting to say, oh, that's so-and-so, and that's how she is. Oh, that's so-and-so. And now, like the man with the withered hand, we have become accustomed to being withered. He all right. He all right. It's called a soul. That's what it's called. And that's what we don't recognize. It's called somebody that's weary. But in the midst of their weariness, they can hear God say, come to the altar. And we are used to that. Because now we got security in the character. I'm not hearing y'all. The people that really need to help can't even come to the altar. Who am I preaching to? And the Bible said, looking back at you. And the Bible said, I'm not from here. And the Bible talking back to you. The real glory of God. The real glory of God. Yes. The real glory of God. Yes. Gotta come back. Yes. It's already gone. Yes, it is. Yes, it is, Dr. Johnson. I'm talking about the real glory about it. The glory when you used to get up and go down in Manhattan and sit on the corner. And wasn't nobody giving you a check. And wasn't nobody saying nothing. But you used to sing as your people would fall on their knees. And get said, I'm talking about that glory, boy. I'm like, well, you're not hearing me. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. We're going to sit back and just listen. I got to say this. Are we just going to sit back and let the ministry dry up with all of our issues and all of our complaints? Or are we going to understand that we've been left with an inheritance and God is holding us responsible to maintain the Shekinah glory of God? Catherine, are you just going to keep sitting there and just being a little intercessor? Or are we going to get up and do something?
Poison invested.
Why we ain't anointed? It's poison invested. The highest of Miss Cummings doing, she all right, but girl, you know how to poison infection. Poison infection. How is Miss Morgan? She all right, but you know that love poison infection. And the Holy Ghost said, stop it. The Holy Ghost brought me to tell all of us, stop it. The Holy Ghost brought me to tell all of us that he keeps bringing us back to this spot. Because we are still in this spot. But back of it, I take a shot. And for souls, he got a machanda. And I don't care who we bring in here. Hey, I'm the word I'm not shot. I'm asking God to let that plane be delayed. If they not having no power, let them, I'm not hearing y'all. Let them cry.
Yes, sir.
and didn't just touch it because of what sat on the box.
Right.
It touched that because of what sat in the box. Because in the box was Aaron's rod.
Yes.
That said,
come on,
you ain't gonna look at me
right
when I get to church
right
like you don't do it. Because he chose me. And no, you don't get it. How did he choose it? It said, Nimrod from Ephrath and Olivebrook and Lehi. And the next morning, God would choose the one that bucked. But it bucked with no attachment to the ground. It bucked with no ministry time. That shot up a shot. It bought it when people didn't like it. It bought it when they talked about it. It bought it when they thought he was a lone joker. But when the almond tree bought it, almond lit the quest to awaken in the winter time. So when God called you, it may not be your style. When God called you, it may be your time.
Thank you.
son, child. He chose me, but it wasn't no right to refresh my brain. He chose me, but I didn't have fertilization. What the blind? He chose me out of my season. And that's why the Bible said that weeping may endure for a little
God told Moses,
God told Moses, I want you to wrap up everything that's in the holy places and the most holy places. Watch this. That's going to represent the tabernacle is about to move. So when he said, we are the royal priesthood, and then he said that we are the temple of the Holy Ghost, and we are the tabernacle, then he said, tell the Kohathites, let them walk to the door of the holy place. Wrap everything that got power on it, that represent completion.
Jesus, my God.
Wrap it up in blue, because blue stands for truth.
Yeah.
And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. And he said, if this is the part that caused me to just shout, I'm talking about get up and dance. He said, and listen, when you give them the different things to carry, wrap it in blue, and don't tell them what they carry, but just tell them that it's something holy.
Of the Holy Ghost. I want to be convicted.
Church cute. Yeah. But you ain't got no fire.
Come on.
How are we in a secular Bible and universal meeting? Both of y'all say that completely made up.
Come on.
Catch on fire.
Catch on fire.
And everything about us stay the same from the beginning of the service to the end. But you ain't got the Holy Ghost. You got your Holy Ghost.
Yes.
That praise God when you want to praise God.
Right.
That get happy when you get happy.
Right.
And do you know why? Because the Shekinah glory, the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat, was about what Jesus did for life. And we done lost our memory about our own salvation. Because we live so raggedy.
Yes.
We're not excited about being saved no more. See, I'm not getting about talking even out of the laptop. Because our hyper crisis at such a low state. When we say praise the Lord, if it ain't for a car or a house or some money, we act like we don't know how to praise Him. But when I look back over my life, keeps me in the presence of my people. When I see a sacrifice on the altar.
My God.
When I see blood on the mercy seat.
My God.
So you ain't brought nobody to Jesus, and I don't know when.
Come on. See? Oh my God.
That's why.
See,
you say, but the glory is not on your
mind. That's why the glory is not on your mind.
This is why the believer keeps struggling. We keep praying for a miracle.
Right.
Wait a minute. When provision was provided, and the reason why the bowl of manna stayed in the Ark of the Covenant, to remind you that under divine provision, provided, blood is on this mercy seat.
Blood is on this mercy seat.
I will give this church miracles. It has never seen.
you have left women and men wandering into this tent and don't even know why. I pray tonight that every believer that's standing in this room will become so conscious, and they will bring somebody that needs to be saved. We ask you, Lord, don't move your Chicago. We give you our word tonight that when you look and see your blood on the mercy seat, it won't be inactive. When you see it, there will be sacrifices on our altar that prove that we kept your works alive. The devotion.
Come on!
I lost pictures, I lost numbers, and I didn't lose my mind.
and enjoy the water, but looking down at our phone. As soon as the water brings, sit down, get your phone, put your phone down. God is calling you to come to the right door and allow the purification of holiness and righteousness to come back into the house of God. Who am I preaching to? Or am I preaching to myself?
Come on. Just follow.
Come now, all of us.
$130 is nothing in comparison to what God's going to do. Come now. Come now. Somebody said, well, I can't afford to. You can't afford not to. I'm not responsible for how you respond. I'm just going to say what God tells me to say. That's all. I'm just going to say it. And if he said it, it'd be you. And if he wasn't said, it'd be nobody.
That's the thing. That's gorgeous. www.ccm.org. And sow your seed, $13.133. Sow a seed into the big gospel. Sow a seed in your soul. That's what this is all about. Just go to our website, ngcm.org, or you can text it, and you're going to be blessed because God is faithful to his word. Listen, get out to the tent. Bring somebody to you. Bring your loved one, your family, your friends, someone who doesn't know you. That's why the tent is here. My father put it up 45 years because it's about souls. Your promise that it's about souls. See the unsaved saved. My friend, this is the right place. Is that what it is? Where is Sarah in the tent? That's where you gotta be. This week, you gotta be in this tent. Watch it, Mary Boulevard, on the big gospel tent. God bless you.